Okay, welcome back. In this latest video, as we work our way through the economics of the balance of payments, I want to focus on a crucial issue, particularly for year 13 economics in IB. How do you finance a current account deficit? So here's the picture for the UK. The UK's current account deficit is shown here since 1985. In fact, in the last 20 years, we've run a current account deficit every single year. And the current account is basically a measure of the country's balance of payments with the rest of the world, measured in terms of trade, exports and imports of goods and services, primary income and secondary income. There's the chart data. I've just put together a little summary here for you in tables. So we run a substantial trade deficit in goods, offset quite a bit by trade in services, where we run a surplus. So we have an external trade deficit in goods and services of about 1.5% of GDP. And we also have deficits now in primary and secondary income. The result being that in 2019, the UK ran a current account deficit, an external deficit, in other words, of just over 4% of our GDP. This table, taken from the latest International Monetary Fund statistics, is a really interesting table showing countries with current account deficits. There's the UK figure. IMF has them slightly lower at 4% in 2019. Countries like Nigeria and Chile running similar sized deficits. And as we go down, there are some countries there with substantial, huge deficits, well in excess of 10% of their national income. And can you see countries like Mozambique, Lebanon, Malawi and the Maldives, they're running external deficits in both of those years shown, well in excess of 1/5 of their national output. Now, those are very large current account deficits, and clearly that raises issues about sustainability. How can countries continue to run such large deficits? Now, here's the really key point when it comes to understanding the balance of payments at A level. If a nation is running, operating an external deficit, a current account deficit, then that deficit has to be financed. Overall, the balance of payments accounts do balance, they sum to zero. But if you're running a current account deficit, that means, let's consider the UK, for example, that means that the UK is a debtor nation and is having to borrow, effectively borrow money from the rest of the world. To finance an external deficit, the UK, for example, needs to attract net inflows of money on the financial account. We covered that in a previous video. So if you're running a current account deficit, you must attract net financial inflows to finance the current account deficit. Now, there's lots of ways that one can do that. For example, the UK stock market might be doing well. Share prices rising on the FTSE 100 or the FTSE 250 index. And it could well be the case that the share prices are rising and property prices are doing quite nicely. And that could attract an inflow of portfolio flows from overseas investors looking to buy stock and property in the UK. That would be a financial inflow and would help cover a current account deficit. Although it does mean that overseas ownership, overseas holdings of assets such as shares and property and bonds will be going up. It might also happen, you can also get an inflow of financial money coming in via hot money. And that tends to happen when a country's interest rates relative to others are high. So if the commercial banks are offering a generous rate of interest on savings, that could attract inflows of hot money into the commercial banking system. Another way it can happen, another way to finance a current account deficit could be when UK businesses perhaps sell some of their overseas assets. They divest perhaps an overseas subsidiary and the money raised is returned to shareholders, comes into the UK and counts as a financial inflow. Or another example, it can be financed when overseas investors have an appetite, a desire and a demand to buy new issues of government debt in the bond market. So what's the really key takeaway point here if you want to understand the balance of payments for your A-level? If a country is running a current account deficit, they need to run a financial account surplus, net inflows on the financial account. Typically, that's done by attracting inflows of investment. Could be foreign direct investment, it could be portfolio flows, it could be hot money. If they can't do that, if a country can't attract that, then under IMF exchange equalization rules, countries would have to make an adjustment to their reserves of gold and foreign currency, because a fall in the reserves is counted as a plus on the financial account. Here's the data for the UK balance of payments in 2019. We ran a trade deficit in goods and services of just over £30 billion. Our net primary income and secondary income, again, was negative. So that overall, we had a current account deficit in excess of £95 billion. I said in the previous video, the capital account is actually tiny and can largely be ignored from the point of view of understanding the balance of payments. Net errors and omissions is essentially there to pick up some of the hard bits of working out all of these flows across countries. There's going to be errors in the calculations. But can you see, for example, here that the UK had a current account deficit of 95, but had net financial transactions of plus 107. So in 2019, although we ran a deficit of over 4% of our GDP, we were able as a country to attract net financial transactions coming in to more than offset that. Overall, the balance of payments, the three bits at the bottom there, add up to the current account and should sum to zero. So the UK is in that sense in a favourable position. It's not necessarily good news to run a large current account deficit, although it does depend on the causes. But in 2019, the UK was able to finance its current account deficit by being a net importer of capital, by essentially borrowing money from overseas investors. Okay, so what about the impacts of a current account deficit? Let's think about why a current account deficit matters. First of all, just in pure aggregate demand terms, if you're running a current account deficit, then there's going to be a fall in demand because X minus M is negative, and that's going to be a drag on GDP growth. If growth is weaker, then that could lead to a slowdown in investment and also perhaps fewer jobs. A large external deficit in most countries, particularly if you have a floating exchange rate, represents a net leakage of demand from the circular flow, a net outflow of currency, and that should in theory lead to a depreciating exchange rate. That's one of macroeconomic effects. And the external deficit itself may actually reflect weaknesses on the supply side. But the crucial point, I suppose, initially, is the high external deficit has to be financed by attracting a net flow on the financial account. And that essentially involves allowing overseas investors to buy, acquire a nation's assets. The big point is if you have a big external trade deficit, for some countries that leads to a loss of confidence by foreign investors, and it can also lead to a big fall in foreign exchange reserves and perhaps leading countries to have to borrow money. Okay, what we'll do in the next video is think about what causes a current account deficit.